Okay, hello everybody, hello Zehava, and Carney and Orcheli and all the rest of the gang. What a wonderful time we had together, and I'm honored to come back and talk to you, and hopefully to make sense of almost what, like 30 years of collaborative work from with so many people here. So that's wonderful. Let's see if I have the my presentation here. Limited time, but I try to talk today about neuromarkers of PTSD and to try to connect it to psychosocial and epidemiological research. This really started with the work of Zahava and Dr. Evelyn Bromet, who is here today, which is wonderful. This is a list of the grants that I have to disclose. And here's the problem. The problem is that trauma exposure is very common globally, and up to 80-90% of the population. However, only small proportion, or as Zahava was used to say, significant minority, will develop PTSD over time. And PTSD is highly heterogeneous, which is, I think, a substantial problem. And commonly comorbid with other disorders, especially depression, which makes everything more complicated. And in addition, many of PTSD patients, especially war veterans, will never seek treatment. They avoid treatment. Avoidance is part of the syndrome. And those who receive treatment, about half or even more, are not responding to current treatment. So the idea is really to develop better tools and more objective measures to quantify the risk for PTSD. In my case, to identify the neurobiological basis of PTSD and eventually to target treatment towards these neurobiological markers. Couple of words in the background, just for the sake of kind of connecting to this auditorium and to this school and to the great things that has been done, started here. So this is one of the tanks, the Magach tank, the Patton tanks in the Chinese farm in Yom Kippur War, which really led me to try to understand what happened to me and to my friends and to other people. In the background is always generations of European Jews that have been persecuted during the World War II in what we name ongoing and repeated exposure, same with prisoners of war in the Yom Kippur War. Some of them were my friends and colleagues that kind of inspired us here at the School of Social Work to do to study them and to think about rehabilitation and treatment. In particular, I think Carney's, you know, stage that right. I think Zahava's book or Zahava's, you know, enormous research efforts towards understanding early stages of post-traumatic symptoms after exposure was so seminal to understanding long-term psychopathology. And which can lead to people who kind of run away. And this is Valsan Bashir, which I really recommend everybody to see and also to look at the beautiful animation in the book. And then kind of, you know, leading myself later on when after the attacks of 9/11 to study, understand, and treat 9/11 victims, creating training programs for psychologists, and eventually kind of zooming in on the neuroimaging research. So as I say, trauma is very, very, very common, and almost kind of on a daily basis, almost everywhere. And this is not a big deal, despite, you know, efforts to understand trauma, quantify trauma, trying to learn what is really, what makes trauma really a trauma, or what's the difference between stress of trauma. So trauma is very common. This is a good WHO research in numerous countries, finding between 50 to 90% of the population to endorse a criterion A traumatic event. However, only few of the people who are exposed to trauma will develop PTSD. As I said before, this is data from the prisoners of war studies in Yom Kippur War, retrospective data about PTSD early on after Yom Kippur, and present data 18 years later. And what we see that despite very, very extreme exposure to trauma, including interrogation, humiliation, isolation, sometimes sexual abuse, and torture, only about one quarter of the POWs will develop PTSD, which suggesting that the majority of the POWs, at least at baseline, didn't develop PTSD. Some of them, or many of them, will show a vulnerability later on. And 18 years after the trauma, only 13% of the POWs met criteria for full PTSD. And what can also be seen here in this slide is that the severity of trauma play a huge role in the risk for the disorder. So, and lastly, the fact that many of the people who develop PTSD early on will eventually recover or remit from PTSD down the road, either with treatment or naturally. So what we have here, and this is data that confirm what I just said among 9/11 victims. This is data from kind of a New York-based study, Galia and colleagues. Even in the most severely exposed people in 9/11, only about 15% develop PTSD, and those people will eventually, most of them will eventually remit, and rates of PTSD will be diminishing in the community. So the question is really what's going on here, and I think what's going on, and here I agree with a very nice paper written by Rachel Yehuda, another Israeli, former Israeli, and Joe Ledoux, kind of presenting the idea that perhaps post-traumatic stress disorder is a syndrome of deficient recovery, suggesting that those who are unable to recover from symptoms, those are develop kind of long-term chronic course of PTSD, and we know these people. This is to say that the majority of the individual really expected to show some degree of resilience, but those who do not develop PTSD, and the idea really to understand why. And there are various ways to understand why, genetic ways, neuroimaging ways, psychosocial predictors. I will present data today about the brain. So the idea that our brain is a place where everything will happen is not a new idea, of course. It's trivial. But in PTSD, what I think is very interesting is the idea that PTSD is really a fear disorder, a fear-related disorder. It's really about fear processing and fear expression. And there are certain areas in the brain that are highly involved in both fear processing and fear expression, especially the amygdala, but also the relationship between the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex. And there are numerous studies that suggesting that there is something very interesting happening between the fear hub of the amygdala and the top-down and kind of deficient top-down processes between prefrontal cortex and the amygdala. Adding to that is the central role of the hippocampus. Hippocampus is really key to understanding memory processes and learning processes, and very much involved in memory storage and memory retrieval. And PTSD is really about memories. If you meet a PTSD patient and ask what's going on and what's happening, it's really about how this patient memorize. Memorize can connect to memories, to past memories, And in many PTSD patients, memories are so vivid and so fresh as if things happened really yesterday. And here is a very nice kind of fear processing model, starting with kind of pre-exposure vulnerability towards exposure to trauma and the early expression of fear. But basically, as we all learned, you know, with Zahava over the years, there are two pathways. The first pathway is really towards pathology, and the other pathway is really towards recovery. And it's really not very clear who will go where, but if somebody kind of develop over time more pathological manifestations, usually this person will overgeneralize the trauma, kind of inability to distinguish well between safe and dangerous cues, while those who eventually recover or remit from PTSD will be able to discriminate better between the two and to extinguish better traumatic memories. So it's really, I'm kind of try to zoom in about the idea of extinction or extinguishing traumatic memories. So we're talking about memories. Memories are fear-related. And the idea is whether a person with PTSD have really problems to extinguish traumatic memories. And just to highlight a little bit of ideas here, so we don't see really difference between PTSD and non-PTSD resilient individuals on the ability to fear learn or to do fear conditioning, neither to learn extinction, where there is a greater decrease of conditioning fear over time. But the problems are really about extinction recall. Extinction recall is whether the individual can retrieve and express extinction memories over time, 24 hours, 48 hours, 6 months, whatever. And here there is really a need to talk about prolonged exposure. Prolonged exposure is a frontline treatment for PTSD. And the whole idea of this treatment, kind of envisioned by Edna Foa and others, is really to facilitate extinction by bringing the patient to the office, but also to the environment, and ask the person to confront, not to avoid, but to confront trauma memories, emotions that related to the trauma, and all sorts of conditions. And the idea that if we do that enough time, there will be really an extinction of the traumatic memories. And indeed, in a number of studies that that I was kind of lucky enough to do in New York in the last 10, 15 years, the idea was to pick up this idea of this treatment, you know, to use a prolonged exposure treatment and really to see whether this treatment is able to improve the way patients do fear processing, both in symptoms and in the brain. I would like to show you a little bit of data. So this is a paper that Liat Heltman, who is here in the audience today. Thank you for coming, Liat. Did in my team a couple of years ago, and she focused on whether extinction recall, you know, can be improved, and what are the neural correlates of extinction recall. And Liat found that the anterior cingulate cortex, especially the rostral side of the anterior cingulate, is really key to recall of extinction memory or to retention of extinction memory over time. The idea is that the RCC is really involved quite intensively in the kind of connection between the emotional side of our brain and the cognitive side of our brain, emotional amygdala side, cognitive, you know, more of the prefrontal cortex, and we found that that over time the RCC is kind of less active in people who have gone through through prolonged exposure. What we did, we really scanned the people with fMRI and an extinction task before and after treatment, and we found that this is really a marker, a nice marker for treatment response in people who have gone successful treatment. And Liat went on and also examined the structural changes in the brain over time, whether the structures, the volume of the brain is really changed as well. And she found that at the same brain region, there is a significant reduction in volume and in thickness over time, showing that the changes are not only functional but also structural. So there is kind of more evidence about the crucial role of this brain region, but also the idea that the less this brain region is active and the smaller it is, or the shrink, and whether it's kind of shrinked over time, made the person feel better, probably also symptomatically. And lastly, if we talk about a kind of a key thing that we can do with neuroimaging, is a kind of a relatively new way to measure connectivity between brain regions, functional connectivity. By the way, there is also structural connectivity, DTI. In this case, we looked at functional connectivity. And also here, we saw that comparing PTSD patients who went into treatment and to trauma-exposed healthy control, who didn't go over treatment but were scanned twice before and after treatment, we saw dramatic changes in a number of pathways. And in this case, there is increased connectivity between amygdala and prefrontal cortex, and increased connectivity between, and interestingly enough, there are two brain amygdala brain regions with kind of different functions. BLA is more about fear processing, CMA is more about fear response, and in both pathways between amygdala, both regions, and prefrontal regions, there is increase in connectivity over time, which is a very nice effect. And there is also beautiful effect of increased connectivity between the hippocampus, the center of memory and learning, and medial prefrontal cortex. And the relationship between one pathway, the CMA, and the OFC and symptoms were significant, suggesting that we don't only see changes in the brain, but we can also at least partially see nice correlation between the brain and the clinical symptoms. But apparently, and most commonly, you know, PTSD is not a single homogeneous disorder. And I remember working with Evelyn Bromit before 9/11, and we thought quite a bit, and also wrote a paper on comorbidity between PTSD and depression. At that time, it wasn't clear why so many PTSD patients have also depression, major depressive disorder, which seems kind of a little bit like a mystery. It wasn't clear whether depression comes first and then PTSD, or vice versa. What are the relationship between PTSD and depression? And this area was really very interesting to me over the years, especially because as a clinician first, I found so many people with PTSD to exhibit also depressive symptoms, which I'm sure those of you who are doing clinical work are very familiar with it. And not only that, not only 50% of the people with PTSD have MDD, they're also showing greater distress, higher suicide risk, and poorer treatment responses compared to PTSD alone. And the question is whether PTSD and PTSD comorbid with MDD, with depression, have different kind of neurobiology. And I have a little bit of data on that, which may be kind of interest. First of all, the area that we were very interested is a nucleus accumbens, it's part of the stratum. Stratum is really very much involved in reward motivation, reward processing, seeking pleasure, going after pleasure. So many PTSD patients are really disabled, especially in that they are sad, they are avoidant, they gave up on the great things that can be found in this world. and we were looking at whether the NACC is really important here, and we compared people with resilient people with trauma exposure, non-PTSD, to PTSD alone, the red bars, and PTSD, MDD, PTSD comorbidity with depression. And indeed, we found that those with PTSD comorbid MDD have the lowest connectivity between the amygdala and the cortical core, and the OFC, you know, one of the prefrontal cortex regions. They also have very low connectivity compared to control on the pathway between the CMA and the thalamus. But especially here, look at the stratum, the NACC thalamus, NACC hippocampus. The green guys are very, very low in connectivity. If they have PTSD, MDD would suggest kind of different neurobiology. And the question is whether how we can help them clinically. You know, what is the best way to help them? And since we did prolonged exposure for our PTSD patients, we looked, we compared people with PTSD, MDD, PTSD comorbid with depression to controls, and what we found here that PE really targets very well fear circuitry, the BLA OFC, but almost no effect on the reward circuitry, on the relationship between the stratum and the hippocampus, et cetera, which suggests that really this part of the problems in the brain are not really accessible if we are doing PE alone. And this kind of led my team over the last couple of years to think, so what can we do really? What can we do in order to address the problems of people that have both PTSD and depression better? And there are all sorts of ideas. In this case, we used IPT. IPT is interpersonal therapy, and done very well in depression, also bipolar depression, some anxiety disorders. And our friend John Markowitz put together a great study comparing prolonged exposure to IPT, and indeed demonstrating that IPT is doing quite well both in CAPS, both in PTSD and depression, especially for people who have comorbidity of PTSD and depression, but also people with sexual trauma. And to close this this short talk, I can't give up on the idea to tell you that we are doing treatment with horses for American veterans with PTSD. So horses are really the therapist. There is a long story behind that, you know, but nevertheless, we found it like a funny thing to do, very much sought after by the veterans themselves. They love horses, they love the nature. It's a group treatment of 3 to 6 people, 90 minutes at session, 8 sessions, and there are psychologists and horse experts in the arena. No riding, only groundwork. And we see quite, this is data from the first 2 groups, very nice results on reduction of PTSD symptoms over time and reduction of depression symptoms over time. And we don't know why. We have some ideas why. The hypothesis is really that the horse is, in addition to the fact that it's a beautiful, beautiful animal, it's also big and frightening. The horse himself or herself is a prey animal. You know, it's not a hunting animal. A lot of hyper vigilance and fear and anxiety, responding very dramatically to the anxiety and stress of the patient. And there is a beautiful opportunity between the PTSD patient with all kind of the fear processing abnormalities and the horse to interact and to achieve some bonding. Perhaps that's behind it. We do MRI to the patients before and after treatment, so we'll see whether there are also effects on the brain. So in summary, and I hope I didn't rush it too much, I think that clarifying the basis, the neurobiological basis of PTSD may help in understanding what is really PTSD, perhaps to improve diagnosis, to improve relationship between PTSD and depression, and perhaps other disorders. You know, there is a lot to study here. We found that neuroimaging is a lot of fun and interesting, and perhaps providing some objective data, objective markers that can help to target better treatment. So if we know where in the brain the disruption is and we can quantify it before and after treatment, we can see whether a particular treatment may achieve the goal of treatment. Importantly, despite the fact that PTSD is very much about fear, you can see that there are kind of strong evidence that it's also very much about kind of depressive symptoms, avoidance, both cognitively but also very much emotionally, and this is why to change the reward system is so key, probably to the health of so many veterans with PTSD. And I gave you some examples of whether we can also think outside of the box sometimes to apply treatments from one area to the other, and perhaps also to use animals in the treatment of PTSD. So thank you. I would like to mention that one of my kind of heroes I never met and is a guy that came to America after the Holocaust. Shalom Ash was a writer, and he was saying that perhaps it's not the power to remember, but it's very much the opposite. The power to forget is a necessary condition for our existence, and I kind of tend to agree. So thank you very much.